So on the way, proving Brouwer's invariance of domain, we proved a topological criteria for a point of a subset of Rn to be an interior point of the subset. That was theorem 6.8. Using that theorem, let us complete the proof of Brouwer's invariance of domain, which is now very easy. After that, we need to complete the proof of the control homotopy lemma. Then the entire proof of Brouwer's invariance of domain will be completed. Okay. So let us start proving the final theorem, 6.7. So for this, we have two subsets x and y of Rn and a homeomorphism from x to y. This homeomorphism, you have to understand that it is defined from x to y, not on the whole of Rn to Rn. If there is a whole homeomorphism from Rn to Rn, which takes x to y, then this theorem is obvious. Okay, then open subset, image of open subset will be open. The crux of the point is this H is defined only from x to y. And it may not be extendable to the whole of Rn. Okay, but we want to prove that if x is open in Rn, then y is also open in Rn. So, what is the method here? Namely, the boundary, the relative boundary, goes to the boundary. Because the homeomorphism, the rest of the points, namely interior, will have to go to the rest of the points there, namely interior complements, right? So if you want to say the interior goes to the interior, rest of the, this is the kind of thing that we want to solve. So this we have to do for every closed ball B contained inside X. Okay. So if I show that for every closed ball B contained inside X, boundary of H of B is equal to H of boundary of B, then it means H of the interior of B is interior of HB. Okay, from this, what will follow? It will follow that H is an open mapping from X to Rn itself as a map into Rn. Of course, the map is from X to Y, but Y is subset of Rn. So this open subset in Rn, because take any open subset of X, which will be the union of interiors of such balls contained inside X. Okay. So union of all this is equal to union of these open sets here. These interior of HBs are open subsets of Rn. Therefore, it will follow that this whole mapping is open mapping, and in particular, Y, which is equal to Hx, is also open mapping. Because X itself is open, is started, we started with. Okay. Only when you assume X is open, we get Y equal to Hx is open. So all this open exercise now happening inside Rn. Okay. So we want to show this equality, H of boundary of B is equal to H of boundary of H of B for every closed ball B contained inside X. Now, the closed ball is a compact set. H restricted to B, to HB, is a homeomorphism. Therefore, I can apply the previous theorem for compact subsets. See, the previous theorem 6.8 was for compact subsets. So that is how this problem for arbitrary X is reduced to compact subsets. So that is the key here. Okay. So now we can apply 6.8 to both B and HB, which are both compact. Because B is compact, HB is also compact. Take a point in the boundary of B. We have to show that HX belongs to the boundary of HB. Right? But the theorem 6.8, it is enough to prove that this HX has arbitrary small neighborhoods V in HB such that every continuous map from G from V to SN minus 1 can be extended to over to whole of HB. So this was a criterion for a boundary point. Okay. To start with a neighborhood V, whatever neighborhood, V should be neighborhood of HX. Take a function defined on V into SN minus 1. Okay, I must show that it can be extended over to HB. By using H, I will go back to B now. How? Take H inverse of V equal to U. Okay, that will be a neighborhood of X because V was a neighborhood of HX. Okay, and this U is now a subset of our X, our H, a subset of B now, right? So H. So here we have, now we have come to B. Start with HX inside HB, we have come to B by H inverse of B, right? It's a neighborhood of B. If you take G composite set, because H takes U to B and then there is a G, can be extended over to B, okay, to a map such as called a B hat, G hat from B to SN minus 1. Okay, it follows that. If you go back again, okay, come for H inverse and then take G hat, that will be an extension of G over HB. Okay, so there is a typo here. This should be G composite H. When you take H inverse on this side again, it will be just G. So this extension will be extension of G. Okay, why it works on B? Because we started X as a boundary point of boundary point of B. Therefore, we use the criterion here of 6.8. It can be extended. To go back, so that problem is solved, extension is solved in HB. Therefore, HX must be the boundary. Okay. So this means started with H of the boundary, right, is contained in the boundary of HB. But now the argument is symmetry. H from B to HB, but H inverse is from HB to B. Therefore, I can interchange the B and HB, so I get equality. Okay, so this completes the proof of Brouwer's invariance of domain. All right. So it remains to prove the lemma, which is purely homotopy-theoretic now. So we have to work harder here. We have to do what? We have to do simplicial complexes, approximations, and various things here. Okay. So I restate this lemma here. K is a finite simplicial complex of dimension less than M. A is a closed subset of mod K. A map is given from mod K, comma A to DM S minus 1. We have to show that is a homotopy mod K cross I to DM of F relative to A such that the net result, namely H of X1, is a map inside SM minus 1. The whole of mod K now taking values inside SM minus 1, okay, instead of DM. So that is what we have to show. Such a result, what I want to say is, you might have seen in a differential topology course for smooth approximations. There are such results for smooth approximations. Okay? The proof of that and this are not very different. If you have understood that one, this will be easier. If you understand this one, you go back, that will be easier for you. All right? So I am not assuming that you have read that one. But I say that those things are similar. First, we observe that it is enough to prove F is homotopic to a map G relative to A such that the image of G does not contain an interior point Q of boundary of Q of the disk DM. If one point is missed here, from that point I can take the radial projection, which is the deformation retract, okay, onto the boundary DM minus Q to SM minus 1. Take this composite with this one, you get a homotopy of the original map to map into SM minus 1. Okay, so instead of directly showing that there is a map SM minus 1 with homotopic to the given map, we take it to two stages. First, all that we have to do is F is homotopic to a map G, because everything must be controlled homotopy. A should not get disturbed. Relative homotopy, such that the entire image of the new map misses at least one point. Okay? Specifically, one point in the interior of the DM, not on the boundary. All right. Now, just to write down the proof, okay, so that it becomes, writing down the proof becomes easy, instead of the round disk DM, I take a homeomorphism of this pair with the product space J power M into the boundary of J power M. What is J? J is the interval minus 1 to plus 1. You could have taken I power M also, no problem. But I am taking this one. This is also homeomorphic to the round disk. This we know already. And the boundary of this one will be under that homeomorphism goes to boundary of SM minus. So take a homeomorphism here. Okay. Then you make the whole thing instead of DM, prove it for this JM. That's all. So now you have to show that the map G is already taking, F is taking values here, homotopy to a map G such that the G of mod K misses a point in the interior of JM. Okay, now here is the picture. What I am going to do? Okay, so let me first establish these notations and come back to the picture later on. Cut the cube JM by hyperplanes parallel to the coordinate hyperplanes at intervals of length 1 by 4, 1 by 4, 1 by 4, and so on. Okay, so into minus 1 to plus 1, length is 2. So you will be cutting it into 8 equal parts like this. Okay, 8 equal parts in all the directions, in all the planes. That is the meaning of cutting it into this one. In R2, this picture is in R2, you have only two directions, this horizontal and vertical. So take all the planes, okay, parallel to these coordinate planes in all the directions, in all the 1, 2, 3 up to axial directions, and cut it into like this smaller cubes. Okay, at equal interval. This is not very crucial, but you have to cut it like this. Okay, so each will be a cube. Okay, I cross, it's like I cross I m times, right? Now you can just cut it into further triangles and so on and make them a simplicial complex. This way they are not simplicial, but we know that any DN can be given a triangulation. So you take a consistent triangulation for the whole of this one. Okay, any triangulation that you like. So that the modulus of that K is homeomorphic to this picture. All these lines, etc., are immaterial for me, so I have not drawn them here. Only I should know that this is a simplicial complex, that's all. The underlying simplicial complex, just place for the logical part here, nothing more than that. The picture, the geometry is precisely this much. Okay. So now what are these? I'm telling you. So that triangulation, triangulated thing, that simplicial complex, I am denoted by L. Mod L will be equal to Jm, such that each of these little cubes becomes a subcomplex. Okay, the smallest, the eight of them in each direction, so there will be subcomplexes. Choose a subdivision K prime of K. Now K is what? K is in the domain. Map is from K to begin with K to Dm, but now then we converted it to K to Jm, and now this K I am going to subdivide maybe several times by barycentric subdivision, so that you get a simplicial approximation alpha from K prime to L to the function f. Okay. This we know, that we can do this one. Now put this little lj equal to minus j by 4 to j by 4 power m for j equal to 1, 2, 3 up to 4. So now you have come back to this picture. L1 is 1 minus 1 by 4 to plus 1 by 4. L2 is minus 2 by 4 is 1 by 2, minus 1 by 2 to plus 1 by 2. L3 is minus 3 by 2 to plus 3 by 2. L4 is the whole thing. So this is what the picture is. L1, L2, L3, L4. L4 is the entire L. Okay. So these will be automatically subcomplexes of L, contain one contained in the other. All right. So this is what will help us using the controlled homotopy here. Okay. So these Li's are defined like this. J equal to 1 up to 4. Okay. Then Kj is nothing but F inverse of this. I can write it as mod Lj if you like. But Lj, you can think of this as subspace also. F inverse of Lj. Okay. Lj can be thought of as a simplicial complex. Underlying space Lj, like we have taken L is Jm. So don't have to rewrite every time mod is a fair. So Kj is F inverse of the underlying topological space. F being continuous, these are closed subsets. Kj should be closed subsets. Li contained inside Lj, L1 contained L2, etc. will give you K is contained inside interior of K2, contained inside K2, contained inside interior. And you know, interior of K3 and so on, the K4 will be the entire Dn. Okay. K4 is entire K, whatever, to begin with. Whole of K, not necessarily Dn. Sorry. Let eta from K to I, this is not Dn, this is not correct. Eta from mod K to I be a continuous map such that eta is 0 outside the interior of K3, it's a closed set, and identically 1 on K2. So this is where I'm just using that mod K is normal, which we have proved. Okay. On L2, it is identity, and outside this L3, it is 0. So here is identity on this part. From here to here, it takes the value between 0 and 1. Okay, so such a function, continuous function, can be cooked out because it's normal. So eta is 0 outside K3 and identically 1 on K2. Now, instead of taking T times F into 1 minus T times mod alpha, as usual, I take a modified homotopy here. This homotopy is again not very strange because fx and mod alpha fx is are there, and this is going to be a convex combination between f and its simplicial approximation, you know that they lie inside the same simplex. Therefore, the convex combination always makes sense. Look at here, 1 minus t times eta x is there here. And I'm adding t times eta x, sum total is 1. And eta x takes values between 0 and 1. And t also takes value between 0 and 1. So this is also taking value between 0 and 1. Therefore, this is just a convex combination. Makes sense and is continuous, etc. So this entire thing will be inside L. Okay. So g of xt is a homotopy. What happens when t is 0? T is 0, this is just 1. And t is 0, this goes away. This is fx. This is starting function is f. What happens when t equal to 1? It is this map g, 1 minus eta times f plus eta times mod alpha. Okay? So this is our function g, whatever it is. We want to say that this function misses one of the interior points of L1 in its image. Then we are done. All right. Now let us analyze how it is done. This is purely point set topology. Outside K3, what happens to eta? Eta is 0. Is this part 0? This is 0, so it is just fx. Okay. But A is contained inside F inverse of boundary of Jm. Remember that. Okay, A is contained inside F inverse of boundary of Jm, or F of A is going inside the boundary to begin with. The function is from mod K, comma A to Jm, comma boundary of Jm, right? Therefore, this A is contained inside, outside K3, I mean complement of K3. All right, what is K3? K3 is the inverse image of L3. L3 contains the boundary of L, after all. Okay, so look at this picture. So L3 is this part. Okay, so if something is outside this one, so it must be coming from here. But this whole of boundary is there, right? So that's all I'm asking. This set theoretic conclusion here. So we are here. Since A is outside K3, this, whatever we have derived, this applies here. Therefore, G of xt will be x for all x inside A, which means G is a homotopy of F with the map relative to A. So homotopy we have seen, so relative to A is important. Okay. So what we are left out now, we have to show that this G misses a point in the interior of L1. Okay. So we claim that G does not contain some point in the interior of L1. First of all, since alpha is a simplicial map, a simplicial complex K prime, which is a subdivision of whatever we have taken of K, which is again dimension n, is again a dimension n. Okay, it follows that the image of alpha, okay, is contained in the nth skeleton of L. No simplex here will be of dimension more than n, because the same thing applies to K prime. So the image cannot be of more dimension than that. That is a simple thing about simplicial maps, because simplicial maps are defined on points, right? So nth skeleton of L. In particular, it follows that when you pass to mod alpha of K2, K2 is a subcomplex of subset of K prime, the whole of K prime. This itself will be contained inside Ln. Ln is the L skeleton. Okay. But then what happens is G is identically alpha on K2. To go back here. On K2, eta is 1, right? So this is 1 minus t times fx plus t times eta is 1. T times mod alpha x. Okay, and on K2, this is what is this one? So what I have to, what I'm talking. Yeah, so I all that I want is G is mod alpha on K2. Okay, on K2, eta is identically 1. Right, so look at this one, eta is identically 1. So it is 1 minus f, this eta is 1. Right, this is 0, this is alpha, eta is 1. So G is actually mod alpha, okay, on K2. Right, mod alpha of K2 is inside Ln, which just means G of K2 is inside Ln. Finally, we wanted to conclude something about G. So this is one part, so I have marked it as 17. The next part is, suppose X is not in K2, X is in K2, we have taken K2. Then A intersection K2 is empty. This we have seen because A is inside K3, K4, outside K3 and K4. K, outside K3, inside, instead of K4. So A is inside, A intersection K2 is empty. Fx and alpha fx are contained in a simplex. Modulus of, they say, sigma, simplized simpla of L, which does not intersect L1 at all. I wanted to say, whatever X is, where is the picture? Whatever X is, if it is, X is not inside this, F of X is not inside this one, we mean Fx is either here or here. As soon as Fx is here, mod alpha Fx will be also inside the corresponding simplex. Maybe it's a simplex is here or simplex is here. No, it is in one side simplex, which is outside this part. That is all I want. Both alpha and mod alpha x and fx will be in this part. Okay. In one simplex here. It may be one simplex here, maybe one simplex here, maybe something here and so on. Okay, one of them. In one of the simplexes. In particular, it will be one of these q's. All right, so that's all I wanted to know. So this geometry is very much used here. Okay, so what we have what here is that fx and alpha fx are contained in a single simplex of L, which does not intersect L1 at all, no problem. Okay, therefore the line segment fx and alpha fx, the line segment, the entire thing, does not intersect L1. Okay, it is contained inside some simplex which does not intersect L. This whole simplex is inside, this whole line is inside this simplex, and this does not intersect L1. Therefore, this entire thing does not intersect L1, which just means that Gx is one of the points here finally, because G is the end point of this, right? So Gx belongs to this line segment. It follows that Gx is not in L1. As soon as X is not in K2, Gx is not in L1. Therefore, G of mod K minus K2, this is inside L minus L1. Okay, so this is purely set theory. Is it clear? Now put 17 and 18 together. What do I get? G of K, either and point is in K2 or is not in K2. There are two things. So it will contain is Ln or in L minus L1. Okay. Ln will not cover all of L1. Anyway, this part never covers anything from L1. So not all of L1 will be contained inside this one. Therefore, L1 is not contained inside GK. Because L1 is contained as GK would have, L1 is contained here. L1 is not here because it is complement. L1, which is a full simplex, okay, of dimension n, more than n, cannot be inside a n skeleton. All right. Therefore, L1 is not in GK, which just means that the image of GK misses at least some point in L1. And L1 is a, all of L1 are in the interior of model. So this completes the proof of 6.8, Hence, theorem 6.7 is also completed. Okay. So the proofs here are much more educative than the statement of theorems. If you read it carefully, so you should learn many many subtle points here. Okay. So thank you.